I've been an engineer for 15 years now, and I'm often irritated by the way that engineering is communicated to the public. One topic that is especially prone to misrepresentation or like overselling is new renewable energy technologies. Every day, pretty much, I see examples of reporting on new energy technologies where the writer has exaggerated the benefits or the readiness of new technologies and overplayed the issues with existing technologies, making out like the new technology is going to be the sole solution to all of our energy problems. And I get it. It would be really nice if we didn't need to do the hard work of continuing to develop all our existing green energy technologies and developing the policies needed to go along with it to help the process go fast and smoothly. It would be so nice if we just woke up tomorrow and found that a new technology had been discovered that would solve all our old problems and not cause any new ones. But pinning all our hopes on a radical new technology is like buying a lottery ticket instead of just going to work every day. And worse, some of these revolutionary technologies that I have seen recently don't even have a lottery ticket's chance of working. Sometimes technologies are promoted that cannot work. They don't actually obey the laws of physics. Examples of this include like traditional perpetual motion machines or more recently popular over unity motors that you might have seen in some of the dark corners of the internet. These are pretty classic old-fashioned con jobs by modern snake oil salesmen. An example is the president of a water as fuel company, Genesis World Energy. He went to jail for stealing $2.5 million in invested funds for his water as fuel technology. In this video, I'm going to share how you, a non-expert, can interpret a new technology to see if it obeys the laws of physics. If not, it's a scam and you shouldn't write about it or invest your money in it. I hope that content writers and content consumers alike will be able to make better judgments about engineering developments and avoid being deluded or scammed by technological developments that have no promise. I am certainly not anti-new technology. It's my job to innovate and develop new energy technologies, and I love that. But I do it with an engineering mindset, not with magical thinking. Am I saying that you need a PhD in engineering to write or read articles about new energy technologies? No way. You don't actually need to understand every detail of a new technology to be able to assess whether it's like a perpetual motion scam. The method that you can use to do this is to recognize and apply two thermodynamic principles. First, that energy cannot be created or destroyed. Energy can only be transformed from one form to another. And number two, systems tend to disorder. And by that, I mean that differences in temperature or pressure or density, they'll tend to even out over time and they never concentrate without adding energy to the system. Scientists developed these principles in the 19th and early 20th century. And since then, there has not been a single demonstrated exception. So just like you probably feel comfortable to accept that gravity is a natural law that can't just be eliminated by a new technology, you can apply these thermodynamic principles without wondering whether they apply to any specific case. They do. The first law, that energy cannot be created or destroyed, it's straightforward to understand, but it's incredibly powerful. There is a certain amount of energy in the universe, and this amount will never increase or decrease, but its form can change. So examples of energy transformation include when wind energy is transferred to mechanical energy when it hits a wind turbine. Then the generator inside the turbine converts the mechanical energy into electric energy. All methods of generating electricity involve such a transformation of energy from one type to another. The second law of thermodynamics, that systems tend to disorder, is slightly trickier to understand. It says that every time you convert energy from one form to another, some of the energy changes to a less ordered and less usable form. For example, when fossil fuels burn, heat energy from that reaction, it heats up the surroundings as well as the parts that you're, you know, trying to heat. The energy is all still there, but the heat in the surrounding environment, it's in a less ordered state than the chemical energy was, and it's hard to use it. The second law is the reason why when you reverse an energy transformation process, you never get all the energy back in a usable form. So imagine that you connect a generator to an electric motor and then use the motor to power the generator. This is the basis of any over unity motor, and it doesn't matter how many other components you add, like alternators or inverters, the following is still true. the energy within the motor and generator system will gradually decrease as some of this ordered usable energy becomes sound and heat. The sound and heat energy are disordered and less usable forms of energy. And the usable electric and mechanical energy in the motor and generator will eventually fall to zero unless you add energy back into the system, say via a hidden battery somewhere. The application of these two laws of thermodynamics provides a very powerful way of assessing energy technologies. And the best part is that you don't even need to understand all the details of the technology you're evaluating. You only need to check whether the technology claims to be creating energy from nothing or to create ordered energy from disorder. If it doesn't pass this check, then you know it's not a real technology. So let's look at this using the specific example of hydrogen. Hydrogen is the basis of many renewable energy scams, for example, cars that run on pure water as its only fuel source. But hydrogen is also the basis of real ways to convert energy, for example, fuel cells. Hydrogen is the most abundant element in the universe, and it releases energy when it reacts with oxygen, which is another abundant element. The only byproduct from the reaction is water, which obviously sounds very attractive. So how can we distinguish real hydrogen technologies from the scams? So we can start by applying the first law of thermodynamics, that energy cannot be created or destroyed. So if electrical energy is created, it must be converted from another form of energy. This is not negotiable. It's not something that any technological breakthrough will solve, ever. A molecule of hydrogen on its own, H2, contains chemical potential energy that's released when it reacts with oxygen. But large amounts of hydrogen are not just hanging around in the atmosphere as H2 molecules. Nearly all hydrogen is present in compounds such as water or organic compounds. H2 makes up only 0.00005% of air, which is actually fortunate because concentrations above 4% can ignite. Several industrial processes can make hydrogen in high concentration. We can make it from natural gas, from coal, from water. All of these processes require energy as an input into the process. Using water as a source of hydrogen and oxygen molecules is a well-known process and the basis of the production of green hydrogen. That's the topic of much excitement around the world currently, and something that I have also made some videos on this channel. A process called electrolysis passes an electric current through water, which causes it to decompose into hydrogen and oxygen molecules. The resulting hydrogen is a potential fuel source. So a fuel cell, for example, produces an electric current when hydrogen reacts with oxygen with water as the output. If the hydrogen is produced through electrolysis of water, then we have a nice neat loop. First, water plus electricity reacts to give hydrogen plus oxygen. And second, hydrogen plus oxygen reacts to give water plus electricity. So a fuel cell car running on hydrogen produced by electrolysis is, in a way, a water as fuel car. But no one ever went to jail for taking investors' money to develop a fuel cell car. The reason is that fuel cell cars and hydrogen produced by electrolysis are technologies that obey the laws of thermodynamics. Let's look at this in more depth. So we'll start with the second law, that systems tend to disorder. Every time you have a transformation from chemical to electrical energy or the other way around, some of the energy changes to a less ordered form, such as heat or sound. So for completeness, we should really include waste heat in our two equations like this. Water plus electricity reacts to give hydrogen plus oxygen plus waste energy, and hydrogen plus oxygen reacts to give water plus electricity plus waste energy. Now we can apply the first law, that energy can't be created. Since each stage produces some unusable waste heat, we know that the amount of electricity produced in process 2 must be less than the amount added in process 1. If this weren't the case, we would end up with more and more energy each time we loop through the two processes, and that would be a violation of the first law. There are no problems here. We didn't just disprove the concept of hydrogen fuel cells. You just need to be aware that there are losses involved. So in the case of hydrogen produced by electrolysis used in a fuel cell to produce electricity, the round-trip efficiency is around 35%. In other words, nearly two-thirds of the total energy is accounted for by the waste energy portion of processes 1 and 2. There are a large amount of energy technology scams that purport to run on similar processes, but claim to have discovered a new and vaguely described process for separating hydrogen from water. They claim that the new process uses vastly less energy than the current state of the art. Now, technology improvements occur all the time, so the fact that they're claiming an improved efficiency does not in itself prove the technology to be a scam. But the second law of thermodynamics demands that some energy changes to a more disordered, less usable state in the process. This loop of processes one and two will always consume energy overall. And the same is true for any other pair of reactions where the product of one reaction is the input for the other. This is the power of the laws of thermodynamics, and you don't need to understand the chemistry involved to understand the conclusion. Don't believe it? Well, that's okay. Science doesn't ask you to take anything on faith. Thousands of skeptics before you have tested out these laws on supposed perpetual motion machines, and without exception, every case eventually turned out to obey the laws of thermodynamics. And they always will. There are many examples on the internet that claim they have found the exception to the rule, but without any independently verified experimental evidence, because there can't be. Just like we're never going to find a real technology that relies on gravity not existing for it to work. So now you know how to assess new energy technologies according to these two laws of thermodynamics. First, ask where is the energy coming from, as energy cannot be created. Second, check whether the technology relies on one form of energy being transformed to another without any losses. If there are no clear answers to these questions, then either the technology is not understood or it's just a scam. In either case, it's really not the next big thing in renewable energy, so don't write an article about it as if it is, and definitely don't invest your money in it. Have you seen any good examples of new technologies that break the laws of thermodynamics, or perhaps one that seems like it does but you're not sure about? Write about it in the comments. And if you like this video and want to support me to make more similar to it, then please like and subscribe and share with your friends. And check out the other videos on renewable energy technologies on my channel, and I'll see you in the next one.